To the unsuspecting person on Earth, the Sun seems as permanent and unchanging as the land beneath our feet. It provides the light and the warmth that makes life on this planet possible. It's even been said that every hour enough energy from the Sun reaches the Earth to provide electrical power to all of humanity for 1 year. And yet, as a burning ball of gas with a radius 109 times the size of planet Earth, the Sun has numerous explosions of an awe-inspiring size and power. While this has produced dazzling images, it's not at all a safe spectacle. Instead, as we'll see in a moment, solar flares in the next few decades could be a horrible threat to civilization. Number 10. Their immense composition and power. A solar flare is often accompanied by the release of a vast amount of gas, plasma, and irradiated particles called a coronal mass ejection. NASA has reported that the energy released in them would be the equivalent of a billion megatons of TNT. Meanwhile, the largest nuclear explosion ever created by humans had the equivalent of 50 megatons. Despite being mostly gas, they are also estimated to have millions of tons in mass as well. A single instance that erupted from the Sun in 1999 was estimated at being roughly 35 times the diameter of planet Earth. To be clear, that was by no means the largest recorded solar flare. That one came 2 years later. It possessed enough power that the Earth, 93 million miles away, had the number of electron-charged particles in its magnetosphere increase to 10,000 times its usual level. Number 9. Mistaken for a miracle. In June of 2012, there was a report from a team of researchers in Japan that studying the rings of ancient cedar trees on the islands had revealed that there was a spike in carbon-14 that could not be accounted for. It befell a Yale student named Jonathan Allen to figure out an account from Anglo-Saxon historical records of how, in 774 AD, one night an immense red crucifix appeared in the sunset sky, an event which was accompanied by sightings of wondrous serpents, according to the 1847 book, A Catholic History of England. While at the time we can be pretty sure that no one thought of the red light in the sky in such terms as coronal mass ejection, but we do now know that the supposed divine vision was very likely exactly that. There was a competing theory that the red crucifix was actually a supernova, although given how relatively small those are in the night sky, it would have had to have been a very unusual supernova indeed to even have a poorly defined crucifix shape. Number 8. The Year of the Discovery. Sort of. It might seem odd considering that seemingly esoteric aspects of the solar system, such as the four moons of Jupiter, were discovered by Galileo as early as 1610, but the nature of solar flares was completely unknown until the 1st of September 1859. The circumstances of its discovery were quite modest until they became absolutely spectacular. Cambridge graduate and amateur astronomer Richard Carrington happened to notice black spots on the Sun. Then he saw two massive patches of white light erupting from those black spots. By nighttime, the event he just witnessed would make its effect known all across the world. The skies glowed so bright on September 2nd that, in some areas, teams of workers went out under the assumption that the day had begun. Elsewhere, the skies glowed such a bright red that reports of fires went around. As it happens, there were real fires. They happened to be at telegraph offices, where the surge of electrical power from the Carrington flares would cause paper to burst into flame. At the American Telegraph Company in Boston, telegraph workers went through a process of finding their machines didn't work, and then that they could get them to work without switching them on due to background energy. Then, by 10 a.m., their machines were working normally again. All told, Earth was hit with more than twice as much energy from the Sun as it would be in any normal recorded solar storm. Even though the event came to be named after him, Carrington was rather unassuming about his findings. When he shared them, he didn't make the connection himself between the coincidence of the solar display he'd witnessed and the bizarre auroras. He wasn't the only one to see flares that day, sharing that honor with astronomer Richard Hodgson. Number 7. The Cold War Flare Scare. While the Carrington event was a natural wonder for its time, it didn't really fully institutionalize the concept of space weather. That had to wait a little over a century until May of 1967. Humanity, almost coming to an end, sort of has a way to shift priorities. Although in those days, to the average person, a series of solar flares didn't really mean anything aside from some pretty auroras, documents that were declassified 50 years later revealed that the United States military was experiencing severe radar failures as a result of the largest bombardment of electromagnetic energy that would hit Earth during the 20th century. The first reaction was to point the finger at the Soviet Union jamming their radar. Fortunately, a program that had been started by the US Air Force only a handful of years previously identified the real culprit. If the notion that this would have led to nuclear war might seem far-fetched, consider that the Soviet Union nearly launched a nuclear attack on the US in 1983 as a result of satellite interference from high-altitude clouds, and you can begin to see where the problem might have been. Number 6. The Halloween Storms. While the US armed forces were able to keep the danger of the 1967 solar flares under wraps, that simply wouldn't have been possible for this 2003 incident, which was the most severe solar event of the 21st century. Despite the name that implies the effects of the solar activity only altered the Earth's magnetosphere for a day, the world was actually subjected to massively increased electromagnetic energy from October the 19th to November the 7th from 17 different solar storms. The impacts included the rerouting of numerous flights that normally had to fly near the North Pole and knocking out the electrical grid of Sweden for about an hour. The eastern seaboard for the United States also nearly suffered an outage. Geophysical surveys and even maritime missions were cancelled. The year-old Japanese satellite IRIDIUS-2 was left completely out of commission, and even terrestrial radio networks were disrupted. The fact that auroras were seen in the skies of Florida and Texas, locations which are usually much too far south for such sights, doesn't really seem like much of a consolation. Number 5. The 2012 flare that nearly ruined us. The harm caused by the Carrington event and the Halloween storms may seem like minor disruptions that became global events. However, by July the 29th, 2012, the world became much more dependent on the telecommunications network, leaving it much more vulnerable when a total of 3 massive flares, 2 within 10 minutes of each other, the largest recorded solar event since 1859, threatened to hit the Earth. Luckily, the circumference of the Earth's orbit around the Sun is 584 million miles, and even with an object about 25,000 miles in circumference, that leaves a lot of room for misses. Still, these 3 potentially disastrous flares were only a week's time from hitting the Earth, which is certainly a near miss in astronomical terms. It's understandable then that, as in 1967, NASA didn't make knowledge of the near miss public, though they only were quiet for about 2 years this time. Number 4. The threat to astronauts. By this point, you might be wondering what would happen if, say, a shuttle of astronauts were caught outside the magnetosphere by the blast from a solar flare. Would they survive? Would they be debilitatingly irradiated? Well, in the case of the International Space Station, even a vehicle that's left in an orbit of 254 miles above the Earth has storm shelters in it. The Halloween storms in particular compelled the personnel aboard to scramble for shelter. In there, fortunately, they were exposed to no more radiation than they'd have been in a trip through an X-ray. Suppose, though, that an astronaut had been caught out in the open in their spacesuit on the moon during a solar flare. Well, this actually nearly happened on the Apollo 16 mission in 1972. According to NASA's own reporting, they would have been subjected to roughly 50 times as much radiation as an X-ray, which certainly would have induced radiation sickness, but wouldn't have been fatal. However, in 1989, when astronauts on the space shuttle Atlantis were caught in a solar flare, analysis published in Storms from the Sun put forward that there was a 10% chance that they would have died if they hadn't been in a shelter. It should be noted that, even in relative safety, a solar flare can be a harrowing experience for an astronaut. In the case of Atlantis, the astronauts reported that they could still see flashes of light from their retinas burning. No matter how much the data might state the radiation levels were not dangerous, that would be deeply convincing that something had gone very wrong with your body. Number 3. Solar flares set the stage for life on Earth. We've mostly talked about how harmful solar flares can be for humanity, and for the next century, we're really going to crank that up. But for this century, let's give solar flares some credit for a change. Much as they might threaten the future of humanity, they are a significant part of the reason that we exist in the first place. In fact, that holds true for pretty much all life on Earth. Billions of years ago, the atmosphere of the planet was composed almost exclusively of nitrogen molecules and carbon dioxide. It was the intense energy of coronal mass ejections that caused the nitrogen molecules to spit out oxygen molecules from the carbon dioxide. It didn't just provide the gas we breathe, it also caused the creation of large amounts of nitrous oxide that would become the greenhouse gases at the top of our atmosphere. Theoretically, on top of all of that, bombarding the loose chemicals on the ground allowed for the combinations that ultimately resulted in the first DNA and RNA. Number 2. Real chance of solar flare disaster in the next couple of decades. There are roughly 1,100 active satellites orbiting the Earth. Each of them has a cost of at least $10 million to install, and some have cost as much as $400 million. Imagine the financial damage that it would do if they were all rendered defective by a massive coronal mass eruption. That's not even considering the damage that could be done to the energy grids for any number of nations for who knows how long. Considering all of that, it's not hard to see why the estimated cost of all of this would be about $2 trillion. So what are the odds of this actually happening? Well, in February of 2012, Predictive Science senior member Pete Riley published in Space Weather that the chance of the Earth being hit by one of these numerous solar flares was roughly about 10% in the next few years. The reason being that the Sun is currently undergoing this 11-year cycle whereby it expands and contracts, and it's currently undergoing a more intense period. Not that we'd be completely safe if it didn't happen during the intense period. The aforementioned Halloween storms, for example, were a bit of a fluke that happened during a period of less solar activity. Number 1. Countermeasures. So, well, how do we protect our current electric grids and communication networks from these coronal mass ejections? Well, the equipment is there, but frankly, it seems hard to imagine us even trying. To give you an idea of the amount of resources that it would require, the Foundation for Resilient Societies estimated that just buying enough equipment to retrofit all of the transformers that would protect electrical grids in the event of a Carrington event-level disaster would cost as much as $30 billion. The same foundation testified before Congress in 2016 that the US updating its energy grid would require roughly 5% of the US's annual defense budget. This is well over $35 billion a year just to update the infrastructure, and that's without any regard for telecommunications. While a 10% chance of an economically ruinous natural disaster is certainly higher than we'd like, it hardly means that we're going to be doomed. So essentially, you'd be looking at selling the world's leaders and population on making such a costly sacrifice for a potential disaster without ever having first-hand experience of one. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, give us a thumbs up below. Do not forget to subscribe. I'm linking to some videos from the archives now. You can also check those out. And as always, thank you for watching.